or does the developer have to write some tests from time to time? So this is a presentation about a set of suite of good practices, not the best practices, but rather like good practices, how you can organize your project, how you can organize your test, so that you say, reduce the amount of maintenance time required to keep the test running and keep them up to date, rather than just, you know, fixing the broken tests every single day. So I found it very useful. I found some of those ideas come from different people, from different conferences, different presentations. So it's like an amalgamation of few ideas. Okay, so today's agenda is the first thing that I'm going to talk about is the difference between declarative and imperative way of writing your test scenarios. Then we will proceed with the way of how you can organize your projects, basically like a project layout. Then a few things about kind of like good practices in writing your tests and automating them. Then how you can deal with complex scenarios, and if we have time, I'm going to talk about a few tips and tricks that you can use to make your life even easier. And everything will be, the whole topic is about the Python framework called Behave. I don't know whether you guys are familiar with it. Who heard about Behave? Who uses it? Great. I hope that one of you might change your mind and start to use that tool because it's pretty cool. Right, so before I actually start, I would like to recommend these two talks from 2012. They are fantastic, especially the first one. As it says, it's about writing classes in Python, and it's brilliant because 99% of the time you don't need to write a class in Python because it's just not necessary. Just create a tiny module with simple code that anyone can understand and patch it, upgrade it, update it, or whatever. And the second one is a talk from a brilliant cucumber, or basically like BT conference. And it's all about the difference between declarative and imperative styles. And it's, these two presentations were kind of like Bible offenders to me. So, here's an example of an imperative scenario where basically you explicitly say what you have to do as a user, or basically the thing that automates or runs your test. So you have to tell it to go to the certain page, you have to enter some text, click on this button, on that button, then you expect to see something there or somewhere else on the page, and so on and so on. So, you know, it might be very easy to understand this scenario because it's like, it just takes you from point A to point B. But the problem with this is that these tests are very brief, you know, and they're tightly coupled with the implementation. So whenever you change something in UI or in the API, because you can use this to also test APIs. I've been using this for like years and it worked just fine. Then your test will be broken and you have to change apart from the code that runs those tests. You would have to change all your test scenarios, which is also a pain in everywhere, in advance especially. So yeah, this is a very bad way to write your test scenarios, and I think some of you might know how this would end. It usually ends like this. It looks great, but then it just falls apart. So, if you think about it, you can rewrite your test scenarios in a more declarative way, more human-friendly way. So instead of saying that you have to click here and there, and your test is, as I said earlier, tightly coupled with the implementation, you can just express the sentiment of the action. So we say, okay, given the user decided to search the internet using this search engine, and he or she searches for some specific term, then he or she should see the expected page among the search results. So it reads more naturally, and it's better for the non-technical people to understand the scenario. And the good thing about this approach is that such scenario becomes immediately a documentation for your set. So a newcomer, let's say you have a new QA programmer or someone from the business cycle, business coming to your project, can just read those scenarios and you will get the gist of the service without actually spending time learning how to use it, because this reads much more naturally. The problem with this is that it takes time to kind of change your mindset so that you can write those scenarios in such a way. And sometimes it can lead into a trap, and the test might become a bit too meta. And yeah, so as people say, everything in moderation. You have to find the balance between the two worlds. Right. So the second part is about the way you can organize your project. And according to the behavior documentation, the minimum requirement for the project layout is basically one folder called features, where you have your feature file, and then you have to have a directory called steps, where you have one Python file or more Python files where you basically implement the test steps. You can use the slightly modified version of that layout. So basically you have, as I said earlier, multiple feature files and multiple files with steps definitions, and you can have an environment file, which is like a configuration file for behavior. It allows you to define the different hooks, like pre-step, pre-scenario, pre-feature, post-feature, and before all, and after all, you can define all sorts of hooks. Which are very helpful. I prefer, honestly, a bit more logical layout. So you move the environment file to the top. You have feature files spread across multiple directories, and each directory is for a specific service. Because I said earlier, this talk is about the person who has to automate tests for multiple services at the same time, and then you can group your tests, sorry, the steps in the implementations in the appropriate folders that would basically match the features layer, the directory layout, and then you have like a common set of definitions or implementations. But unfortunately, this layout is not supported by behave. Sorry, I didn't mention about the pages. Okay, pages is a simple module in which you can keep the so-called page objects. Probably some of you, almost of you, have heard about the page object pattern. It's pretty useful pattern for like defining the actions you can perform on any given page, or if we're talking about the web page or a mobile application, so we can talk about the screen object. But this is not possible. You can't group the step implementations in separate directories. Everything has to be in one folder. So I think the guys from the Behave project might change that in the future, but that's not the case at the moment. So this is what is possible at the moment. And that this is basically the layout that I'm going to use in the second part of the presentation, and I will just show you an example project. Alright, so the third thing, make things easy for yourself. So I'm not sure whether all of you heard about this AAA rule, which is a very good rule. It applies not only to BDD scenarios, but also to unit testing. And I've been writing unit tests up for a while as well, and I've kind of converted a few developers to follow this approach, and they found it pretty useful. So what it's all about, it's about having three kind of sections in your test scenario. So you should always have assumptions. So basically something that describes the environment or sets up the environment, so prepares a database or whatever. Then you have an action. And ideally there should be only one action and then one assertion. The assertion that basically verifies the action that you just performed. So if you, in your scenario you have multiple actions and then multiple assertions, you really don't know what you're testing, because who knows, you did this and then you did something and then in the end you expect to see some strange results. So this triple A rule says that basically avoid that, have just one action, one assertion, and ideally one assumption, but you can have a few more, but keep it to the lowest possible number. And the very good thing that I learned years ago is to keep your step definitions, turn your step definitions into one-liners. So some people, I've seen projects where people basically keep this test step implementation just next to the step definition. And I will explain the difference in a second. But the problem is that it's just a mess. Navigating the file is just a nightmare. So, but when you it introduces like code duplication, which is also a pain in the butt when it comes to maintaining such code. So when you keep it just one line, then you have what you gain is improved readability, and you basically reduce code duplication. The next thing that is a very good thing is to start writing your start making your test steps as generic as possible. And try to always, if possible, or require a parameter item. So add options to pass a actor name or expected element name or alias or whatever depends. It depends on your project. And this helps, as I said earlier, it promotes the dry and yagging rule. So basically, you write less code and you have less maintenance. You can focus on actually adding more test scenarios rather than just maintaining your test suite. The next thing is the keeping the test logic away from page objects. I've seen it in the past that the page object contains some test logic, which was really weird because whenever you change the actual test, you had to change the test logic and then something in the page object, which was just terrible. And if you keep this logic away, you just keep this thing super simple, and anyone can then understand what's going on in that in a page object. Few things to avoid: but steps. So behave allows you to write but step. And I mean, sometimes I think it might be useful, but the problem is that with this is that they introduce just unnecessary complexity to the reader, because when you have to read a scenario where you say given this and something but not something, then it's much harder for you to understand the idea of the project, or of the test scenario. So I'm just saying, just avoid this because it's just unnecessary. And if you're dealing with testing websites, then avoid CSS and XPath selectors. They are just too brittle. Whenever you change something, maybe a tiny thing on the page, they might be broken and just don't work. If your test won't work, and you will have to update everything. So if you can use IDE selectors and force developers. I mean, force. I tried it a few times and it works perfectly and flawlessly. When you ask developers to assign an ID to a important or relevant element on the page, then your tests are almost rock solid. They almost never break because they are nobody actually has to ask developers never to change those IDs. So yeah, I've seen it working in. The benefit is that the tests just work for like months without the need to change anything, which is great. Right, so the next step is we can deal with complex scenarios. So once I worked in a project that we had a mobile app that was kind of like a single user. So you had just one user that logged in, and then he or she could just change some values, add some cars, make payments, and suddenly we've added options to share resources or share money between users. And then there was a problem that I had to update all the test scenarios, and then I had a few hundred of them, and that was a nightmare. So, yeah, but the reason why I had to change them, it was that I had to introduce the option to support multiple actors in the scenario. It wasn't just two, sometimes it was three or four parties. So I decided that since then, when you start writing your test, always add actors and personas to your scenarios. And then the actual extra benefit of this is that you can run your test reliably in parallel, which in order to achieve that, you have to also follow the first step that I didn't describe initially, but it's you shouldn't be relying on pre-existing data. So I see people actually having like hard-coded usernames and passwords in tests, and This is just a bad idea. It never works. It works for a while until everything is broken, and then you call your scenarios and hard-coded values. It's just a terrible thing. And then if you push it to public GitHub or public repo, then you just expose some credentials, which is a pretty bad idea. And as I said here in the presentation, your tests are much more critical because one test relies on different tests on the result of the previous test, and it's just very bad practice. And sooner or later, you will likely realize that you won't be able to run your test in parallel. Last thing that I'd like to describe here is a concept called scenario data. So behavior allows you to pass test data between steps using this context object. You can assign any property to it, a function or whatever. And I realized that I've seen people actually just chucking everything there into random, giving the values, sorry, the properties, random names, and after a while it was just almost impossible to understand what's going on in this code, because the context object had 50 extra properties, and just which ones, which and who should use this or that. So I decided that I will use just one method, a fixed data structure, and I'm using a simple name tuple where I can just track the actors data or step data or whatever data that I need to keep between steps in order to follow the logic. And then whenever I get to access it, I just know what is it, what the name of it. So it's a tiny thing, but it's very helpful, and it helps to debug your code whenever you fail. And it's also kind of a mandatory thing if you want to have multiple actors in your scenario. Okay, so last thing that we're going to talk about will be tips and tricks, but this will be kind of a part of the demo part. So that's it in terms of the presentation. Do you have any questions at the moment? So the first question, very good one. They really don't want to do it. They really don't want to add those ideas because it's a chore. So I figured out that you can attack this issue in one way. When let's say your application or new feature is in the design phase, and a designer has to just make a sketch for the page or the feature or screen in the mobile app or whatever it is, just talk to that person and say, how do you think this element should be called? And honestly, just make a big arrow to that element and say, this would be named, title or email address or something like that. And when you have this, and you hand these designs to the developers, it would be super easy for them to actually just add this, because they won't have to think about it. And so far, I've noticed that this is the only way that works. I hope there are different ones, but I've tried different things and none of them work. I think the only thing that you can do as a QA or software developer is just to do it by yourself. So basically, just get access to the repo and add those IDs whenever you can. And of course, you have to make sure that you didn't break anything. Do you work in agreement with devs or have a short session to predefine IDs for analysis? So, basically this is what I described earlier. No, because they don't want to listen to about at least I know that all the developers that I work with, they know that this is important, not only for me, but as a, let's say, QA, but also to them, because they want to have a reliable test. They don't want to hear every single day, or have to update the test because you've changed the layout on the page or in the app or something. They also want to ship quickly. So this is, tiny thing that can make things much easier and better for you. Robots. Who in the organization is designing and writing those tests? Would you like the robots business analyst before you enter design development phase? So another good question. And as always, they say, is the reality struck me? I'd love business analysts to do it. We don't have them because this is too corporate. Nobody had them in startups or medium-sized companies, so we can just cross that. regular developers. Some do. I've got two guys. One is with a QA background. If he had more time, he would definitely help me to write those tests. And the second one is kind of an early convert, and I think he'd love to do more of this. And basically, whenever he creates a new ticket in Jira, he tends to describe the ticket or the functionality that he gets to add or fix in the PDD kind of a style. So the before, during, after design of the case. So I tend to do it before. It's much better to do it before because that's the purpose of it. You design the behavior of your service, and not you react to existing situations. So do it before, and even if you don't have time to automate them, that's fine. You can use those test scenarios as a kind of a, like basically as a manual test scenarios. If you have manual testers, you can just hand those scenarios to the manual testers, and they will run through those tests. So yeah, I think that would be the answer to that question. Unless you have more, I can proceed to the second part. So sorry for just jumping from one place to another. I just want to hang up. So I already showed you that example. And this is the imperative way. Here's a working declarative version of it. So let's just run it. Search engine, if you like, it's called Serx. You can host it by yourself. It's like a meta search engine. So I might talk about it a little bit later. Let's go back to the code. We have a test scenario that just says, as I said, showed you earlier, uses the Serx as your search engine, Serx for Perryman, and it checks whether you can see some links to it. One thing about the reducing the code duplication, as you can see, I have this test step here, but I also have a test for the other search engine, DuckDuckGo, and we are using the same test step here. And that works only because I make those test scenarios as generic as possible, and I use just the parameterization in those tests. So if we jump to the code implementation, you will see that this step, I mean, I have to tell you the difference between step definition and implementation. So step definition is basically a place where you map the text representation of a test step into executable code. So if you keep this definition to just one line, I mean, just your implementation of the function will be just one line, It's better, it's much easier for you to understand what's going on here. You can then split those step definitions into multiple files. Let's say you can have a common file, as I showed you earlier. You can have step definitions for specific to a one of the services, and you can just keep everything nicely and neatly organized. Not sure whether how many of you actually understand what's going on here. So behaves, so it takes this decorator, which is given when then, and it just checks, it runs kind of like a regex and checks which step matches the step definition declared in your feature file where you have your test scenario. And then if it finds a match, it will just run this code. And in here, I have just a tiny function that just says, okay, this is paid, running the and this function, first, of course, it checks whether there's an actor of that name in the context. If not, it creates a new one. And here's the interesting thing. The step implementation is actually independent of the page object. So it just gets the page objects from nowhere. I will show you later how this function works. And it checks whether it has a required function to execute the action on the page. and then it just executes and updates that and says, yes, the last visited page was this one. So, let me just go to an example home thing, and using an example page object, I wouldn't even call it a page object, I would call it page module, because it's not a instance of a class, it's just a simple Python module, which executes just a simple function, just go to the URL. So maybe now it's the time to explain a little bit about this, maybe a little bit about this idea, how I basically replaced page objects, which is like the class-based structure, with modules. So I decided that in my case, every page object or page module should have just few mandatory properties. So it should have a name, it should say which service it belongs to, what its score is inside, the URL, and extracted selectors. Like here I have the CSS selectors, but somewhere I have the ID selectors. And these selectors are then used in so-called actions. So these functions are called actions in the kind of the page object world. And these actions allow you to interact with this or other page reliably, I would say. So, yeah, so this is an example. Page module, page object. And this function is a bit tricky. It's what it does, it uses an import module basically to scan all the modules in the pages directory. So let me just go back to the presentation. So basically it goes through all those modules in the pages service, and it checks whether the module has all the required properties. And if so, it just adds it to a big enum of all the pages that are there. And then when it says, just get me a page of that name, you just scan the enum and just returns you the module object, and then you can just perform the action on it. So it might be a bit clunky at the first glance, but it's, I would say, much better than using some factory, some crazy thing that you have to use to create an instance of a class. And yeah, I just don't like it. Just keep it stupid simple, as some people say. So, yeah, basically, you have this step implementation that is agnostic of the actual action implementation, which means that you can then reuse that step for a different service or in a different scenario, because it's great if you can reuse your steps in different scenarios, because the only thing that you have to do is just copy paste. Basically, it's a copy pasta work. You just take this step, add another one, change some values, and tada, you have a new test written in 20 seconds rather than just building and understanding the actual code. You can just deal with text, and it's much easier to understand, actually, even for the business person to do it. Some people actually try to do kind of a like online repository of all the steps in your project and expose them via this web service, so that the business people could actually go to that page, see what are the available steps, and they could just do like a drag and drop design of the test scenario. So that was kind of a brilliant idea, but the problem is that someone has to maintain it, and that was apparently a big pain. And I think they abandoned the idea after a while, but it was a great idea, I would say. So yeah, all those scenarios up here are basically built of three different step definitions, and the other feature flag uses the same steps. Behavior allows you also to use those very useful tags that you can just annotate your scenario with, or the example statement. So this is pretty cool about the example statement. It allows you to rerun the same test, the same scenario, as many times as you want. And it's every line in this example statement is treated as a different test scenario. Basically, you can compare it to like parameterized unit testing in PyTest, which is also pretty cool, but I would say less readable. And you can also use those texts on the, as I said earlier, on the examples, which is pretty cool, because if you follow the kind of the idea of tagging your test steps with the actual, let's say, Jira, Trello, ticket, or whatever is the project management tool you use, ticket number here, you can do something like that. As a seller, you can just say, hey, produce ticket, and you provide a ticket number. So when you when the developer has to work on a fix for that bug, or he or she has to implement that new feature, they can just run this step, run this test, because they know on which ticket they have to work on, and that's it. They have a super easy way to reproduce a bug, which helps to save a lot of time to the whole team and move things much faster to the production. So this is a tiny thing that you can. This is a tiny, very helpful thing that you can do with behave. You can also use the values from the examples table as tags, so that when you execute your test, this will be automatically replaced with the actual value. So let me just rerun that test. This was the 0.0.3.11. Okay, and when we have a look at the test results, you will see that the values are just replaced automatically. So you see the category that is videos, and you have the other tags here, like the bug on the test day, because the browser wasn't in focus. But there was one more thing that I wanted to mention in the tips section. How many of you had to work with like automated tests for the browser testing? Like who was running tests in browser for like browser cycles or any other web cycles? Okay. So the problem with such tests is that they suck terribly. I mean browsers suck because they're completely unreliable. I mean they hang, they just do crazy stuff, and it's honestly this is something my last project where I worked with browsers. Really don't want to work with that anymore. But what they did in Behave, and it's not kind of like official feature yet, is option to patch your scenario with auto-retry scheme. So basically, it's kind of like a hidden feature, but I think in the next release they will make it like, they will turn it into a full-blown feature. It allows you just to rerun your test scenario and allocated files, and you can say how many times you can do it. I usually run it just twice, because that's usually enough for browser to basically reload the page and wait for all the expected elements to load, because like sometimes the images take a bit longer than expected to load, or something was blocked, or God knows what, just terrible. So if you have that, sorry, if you have that feature enabled, it, what it will do, it will rerun your test, and it, usually everything is fine the second time you run the test. But if it fails, it fails for sure. Just there's something wrong with either the test or with the system that you're testing, and then it will tell you it failed after two attempts, which is pretty useful, and it saves you time, because I don't even remember how many hours I've spent just analyzing failed scenarios, and the reason why they failed was simply because something didn't load properly on a page, and it's just terrible. That's why I prefer to work with APIs. There's no such problem there, unless you use caching, then you have some other crazy things can happen. Okay, do you have any questions at this point in time? If not, I will move to a few other things. Are there any questions? Sorry, I forgot about that. Do you see such tests as an addition to unit and integration tests, or they are enough to confirm and validate required behavior? So there is this concept of the testing pyramid. Probably you all have seen it. So you have the at the bottom of the pyramid, you have the unit test. That means that you should have a lot of unit tests, and these tests should verify the low level functionality of your service, or basically unit behavior of the unit. Then you have the integration test. And honestly, majority of the text integration tests that I write are written using VA because it's easier for developers to understand this kind of a language rather than Python. I mean, some struggle initially to understand it, but honestly, initially, when you explain them how this thing works, some of them would prefer to have integration tests written in such a way because it reads more naturally that you say, when that service sends a signal to that service, and then the other should receive it, and then he should put it on a message queue, and then something. So it's just this little bit that is required. You have to explain them, and you just need to show them that it actually works. So, as I said, so you can basically write your integration test in such manner. But then on top of the kind of the testing pyramid, you have the functional test or the acceptance test or some call it the unit test. So yes, you can also write your behavioral test or functional test in such a way, but you should strive to have only as little as possible of those tests because, as I told you earlier, they are very brittle, especially when you run them in a browser or on a mobile emulator or even on a real device. So if you have enough unit tests and integration tests that ensure that your backend and the app logic works flawlessly, then you don't need that many functional tests on top of that pyramid, and basically you reduce the maintenance, basically, you know, the maintenance hours that you are required to keep those tests running. But they are very helpful because, as I said earlier, you work as a documentation for anyone who joins your company. They are much easier to understand. You can get some support from the business people. Because then if you convince them to actually spend some time with you writing those scenarios, they will benefit from it. Because I many times have seen situations like that. A project owner has an idea of a PM or VM has an idea of a feature, and they express it in two lines. And then when it comes to implementation, they have no idea what they really wanted. They can't describe the actual functionality of the feature or the new service. And it takes ages to, on those pointless meetings where they have to express the sentiment, basically, of the feature to the developer. And honestly, I did this a few times in the past. It's called the Three Amigos Meeting. Maybe some of you heard about it. Basically, a QA and business person meet, and they basically discuss this new feature or service or whatever, and they try to express this functionality using VDD. It takes a while for them to actually get their head around it. So what they tend to do is just to say, okay, let's focus on the so-called happy path scenarios. Let's just describe, the perfect way, the idealistic way that how it should work. And then QA or our developer can actually add those extra so-called negative scenarios or like unhappy path scenarios to the test suite. So yeah, I think that was a pretty lengthy answer. I don't know. I hope that was enough. How would you compare behavior to robot framework or cucumber? I think I had a look at robot framework quite a lot, and it was quite a while ago, and honestly, I don't remember anything about it. Cucumber, yeah, I got fed up half an hour into the kind of research. It's just the, I hope they changed something or improved things since I looked at it like 2 years ago. The matching engine is just horrible. You have to use regex everywhere. If you had a regex go with it, it's fantastic. But after a while, you will just cry. You say, why it doesn't work? No. So behave honestly. I spent quite a time with it. It's just super tiny, neat project. The support from the project owner and the project team is brilliant. Usually respond within half a day or even a few hours. If they like your idea, they will add it. If you have a pull request, they will add it straight away. If it works, it makes sense. So it's very nice, a very nice process. How do you handle study element scenarios? Yeah, stay elements on the page. I mean, like, basically, that's why we had that auto retry scheme. Just reload the page and check whether it's there. But then there is also a problem of those JavaScript pages where basically they just reload or actually replace the content without reloading the page. So I have this like tiny helper method that usually works, but not always. What it does, it just checks whether the ID of the HTML element in the DOM structure changed. And additionally, you can basically grab the whole page, the source of the page, before you perform an action that will change the structure of the page, calculate a hash of it, and then keep it. And then when, after, let's say, a certain time, or when you detected some event happening, you can just grab the same page source of the source code of the page, recalculate the hash, check whether it's matching. And if they don't, it means that the page reloaded, and then you can follow, continue with the with other actions that you have in your scenario. That works 9 out of 10 times, I would say. So yeah, this repository is publicly available. You can have a look at that. I don't know how to call it, stale element handler, and use it. How do you work with highly dynamic pages and news feeds? Yeah, so this is where the declarative approach to writing the XML comes in handy. You just describe it in a neat and terse way, and you just say, yes, I expect to see that many new entries or feeds or whatever, or I should see, when I do something like that, then I should see a feed from that source, like from Twitter or from Facebook. So you describe the actual behavior or the you don't say that I expect a feed with ID number 27. This will never work unless I mean it will just don't do it. Just express this in a nice generic way and then use some selectors in your actual test code that will match those elements and ensure that these are the elements that you were expecting to see. So this is kind of like the behave and the dynamic pages are like there's no relation between them because with behave you can automate anything. It's just the way you execute your test is relevant to let's say the product you're testing. So you have to basically write some code that will allow you to interact with such dynamic pages. It's doable, it's not difficult, you just need to think about it differently. I hope that answers the question. More questions? No? Okay. Okay, I think I've got actually 2 more minutes. I was expecting this talk to be 30 minutes, but apparently I had like 1 hour, so I hope I didn't bore you to death. Alright, one thing that I would like to show you. This is pretty cool for the business people. Yes, this is a pretty cool thing. So it just scans all your test scenarios and sorry, step definitions, and it will just print the list of all the steps that that you've implemented so far. So basically, you can give that list to a business person and then say, look, here are your local Lego bricks. You want to write a new test, describe a new feature, just take those and just use and you can use it and just write a new test scenario. If there is something missing, just say it's missing, and then you just need to automate that one single step, which is pretty cool. Right, so behave logging, I don't want to go through this because it's not relevant. I've already told you about the values and tags and scenario titles, using ticket numbers for easy reproduction, that's super useful. Retrying scheme, yes, I already told you about this, and this is basically the same thing as previous. So basically, when you pack your scenarios with the appropriate Jira, Trello, whatever ticket number, then you can reproduce them super easily. One thing that I found super useful recently is a way of displaying so-called snack bar when you run your tests on browser stack, for example. Browser stack is basically a service, browser as a service platform. You can run your automated tests in any browser or any operating system. It can be Chrome, Firefox, IE, Safari, or whatnot. And then they have a nice feature of video recording, so you can have a look at the video that from the test execution. But the problem with this is that if you restart your browser after each scenario, or even after every example in your test scenario, you just waste time and money because you have to pay for every minute of the browser execution. And it takes sometimes 15 seconds to start a browser and 5 seconds to tear it down. So what I did, I just decided that I will reuse the same browser session for the duration of the whole feature file. So I have, let's say, 10 scenarios in one feature file. So I will reuse the same session, but after every scenario, I will just clear the cache. But then, in order to differentiate the scenario from another, I will have to display this tiny little snack bar. This is the black bar to the actual test scenario here. And this is very useful when you have to understand what went wrong when you would like to watch that video on browser side. So yeah, the next thing that I want to say is basically the same thing. Last thing, that might be a little bit advanced, I still didn't figure out how to do it properly, is that when you have your page object or page module, whatever you call it, at the moment you can see that, as you can see, I'm using WebDriver to add a new type. It's the best thing ever. Just use if you use Selenium to drive your test, you can in theory drive those tests using a generic driver, and it could be either Selenium or it could be just simple request framework. So you, instead of just doing browser testing, you could just request testing. So that would allow you to run your test much faster. You could reuse the same test scenario, the same test implementation, but slightly modified version of the page object. And because of this, you could just decide whether you want to run your test in browser or using requests. And for example, when you merge something from a branch into master branch, you could just run the test using the request framework. Before releasing production, you would basically use the browser to verify that it works. Okay. Thank you.